sayer. Okay, that is, the poet's job is to say things that you and I can't say. And ideally, what the poet will do is say things so well that when we see through the poet's eyes and mouth, we will have an instant recognition of the truth of the vision. If you remember Emily Dickinson's poem from our Dickinson series, the poet is he entitled us by contrast to speechless poverty. The poet's the one who makes the, she says, who makes the flower by the door. This book for us, for the first time, we're able to say, let's stop and look at it. How would you like the poet who says, stop and look at that dandelion. It may be a vicious weed, but the fact is that one of the creations of nature is beautiful. And the poet's job is to say, stop, look, something you don't look at in the ordinary. I think it's an anti-stoicness, and the poet arrests it to make us wonder why we have not arrested it before. So the poet had a great role. Right in line with Shelley's image, if you remember, the poet for Shelley is the unacknowledged legendary poet of man. Very important. For us, the poet is a sort of ivory tower character who sits off and writes poetry to himself and to his friends, but not to the early romantics. And Merlin is, Emerson, very important poem, but not necessarily a great poem. It's an important poem about what the poet is, how he works. Merlin is the wizard, you know, from Arthur and the Round Table. Merlin in British mythology is a wizard who can only see the future, can't see the past. That's his principle for being able to see the future. So Emerson picks this up, and this Merlin is not Merlin the magician, but it is that character who carries some of the wizard-like qualities. There are a few really nice lines in here, and one of the all-time worst lines of all poems in my opinion is in this one. It is Emerson saying, I may want to be a poet, but I'm not interested in being Longfellow. But his point is, I'm not interested in poetry as an artifice, with talent and skills. I'm not interested in writing poems which are beautiful. The poetry doesn't affect you, and I don't want to write it. So, you see his opening lines as a claim, as Emerson so often does, lays it off. The trivial harp will never please or fill my craving ear. What he doesn't want? Triviality. Poetry outside of that old unpresented relic. What has it? If it doesn't come from need to be expressed, it's not mine. The trivial harp will never please or fill my craving ear. What does the word craving mean to you? Yearning, desiring, wanting so intensely. Its chords, and of course you know this from your own back, the image of the harp traditionally for poets is the image of the poet. Harp is the poet. Its chords should ring as blows the breeze, free, peremptory, clear. No jingling serenader's art, nor tinkle of piano strings, can make the wild blood stand. He is very careful with his words, and something is quite funny. The words for the poet, that is the written poet, obviously very much like Longfellow, he could write a poem on any topic, he could not be done by a poem. And that's right. He says, trivial, jingling, tinkle. I've always thought of tinkling those piano strings as a drag thing. It's felt so easily. It's nice all the time, but that's not, he wants to do Rachmaninoff piano concerto number one, right? Not jazz, not ragtime. The kingly bard will smite the chord rudely, hard, as with hammer and mace, that they may render back the artful thunder, which conveys secret to the thunder track, spark the stupid soul ablaze. Keep your eyes open as a reader, as a student, you get interesting combinations. Artful thunder is a good example of romantic combination. Do you remember last fall reading the poem Snowstorm? Right. Describe the snowstorm coming in and transforming the landscape into an incredibly beautiful phenomenon. Nature does it as a wind. Astonish art is the art. The art requires, he says, to build shape, which art means, the human element of creation, and the spontaneity and necessity that you get from thunder. So the poet should not be trivial. Not branding. It must have been very much of a passion. When I first was taught ever since before, I'll never forget the experience of not really a poem. Except for a few stanzas that struck me as really fine. He didn't sound right. He didn't rhyme properly. And I wasn't even convinced reading him that he had Dickinson's intellectual experimentation involved. I just thought he was incompetent. But he was trying to rhyme and didn't know how to do it. And reading this poem didn't convince me at all that he was doing this consciously. It took a certain amount of my willingness to believe that he's really trying to do something different here before I gave him credit for his work. And I am convinced now. Okay, I will also say that I'm also convinced that most of the time it doesn't work. I think that most of the time his genius is not Dickinson's genius. Dickinson works. Her off rhymes are meant to be that way. Her poems are unforgettable. I don't think his genius is poetic. But I'm giving him the credit of his line, his own claim in this poem, which is, I'm not interested in writing perfectly rhymed verse. I can do it if I want to. I just think the end product is not great. Not to say that it's not important. I think Melville failed totally in what he did. His structure did not work. In fact, his structure is not as important as that. Even though he had a structure that he was planning on presenting to us, and he underestimated our willingness to read about whales. We're not interested in the ecology of whales and how many whales there are. So that structure doesn't work, but the book works. It works massively. It's one of the few books you can read. His attempt to play with form to prove that he doesn't have to sound like a Longfellow. I'll fail. When we get to the point. But he did to record it. But very often, like Melville, the poems are, as a whole, extremely powerful. He makes that point well. So he says you have to break through structure, organization, narrowness, division, and the narrow words you like. You want to hit people and keep them forward fast and keep them forward later. Merlin blows are strokes of fate. Blows here is the image he's picking up. That if you write a poem like a blacksmith makes a bang, you shake up people's world. You rearrange their vision. Chiming with forest tones. When boughs buffet boughs in the woods. Chiming with gas and mold, the ice and crimson flood. Pulse of manly heart, with the voice of orators, with the din of city arms, with the cannonade of wars, with the marches of the brave, and prayers of link and martyrs. The Griffin type series is not present in the composition, but a different way of organizing work. But the point here is that the poem that does it right is in the interior of nature, the exterior. He is doing what the ice does when it breaks up in the spring. That has been during the Great Lakes, for example, when Lake Michigan is finally coming apart. You hear this enormous roar, cracking, and those things from the heart of experience, heart of nature. That's what the poet should do. Great is the art, great be the manners of the bard. He shall not his brain encumber with the coil of rhyme and number, but leaving rule, for thought, he shall climb for his throne. Our teaching has to do. What does he not want? He doesn't want this totally underestimates the value of poets who know how to do that well. If you've read Alexander Pope, you know that here's a man who not only can keep the rhyme but then keep the rhythm but write extraordinary words in the constraints of the style. But that's not what Emerson, he said, you don't sit down and write a sonnet. A sonnet, what are they? Sonnets start you off with 16 lines, 8 and 4, A, B, C, A, 8. Ah. That's what he calls pale forethought. And so his verse looks like this as a consequence. Now the way you look at it so far, what are those lines? It isn't even pre-verse. Because pre-verse tends to have a lot of obvious parallelism. imposing on ideas structure. So you climb for your rhyme. Get up there. Reach up. Make your rhyme come from your need to express what's important. Pass in, the angels say, into the upper doors, nor count compartments of the floors. Mount the paradise by the stairway of the clouds. Very nice line. How will you do when you're in a house? It's an architectural image. You walk into a palace and go up, and all you do is come to room one, room three. He says, you give yourself the freedom to be astonished. And the poetry will take you that way. True. That is astonishment, true astonishment. Mount paradise, stairway of surprise. Blameless master of the games. King of sport that never changes. He shall daily joy dispense, giving sweet sounds influence. Forms more cheerily live and go, what time the supple mind. Simple. It looks weird, but it's really, he's just saying that if you want to sing about what's important, and the music comes to the level of emotion, they all have to be better, no problem at all. So if form, rhythm, rhyme comes out of emotion or idea instead of by person, you start with the end of it, and then you want to say four. Some of us probably know this already from our own education in the past, that in many ways the great distinction between the great poet and the less great poet is that the great poet sounds as though it comes naturally. Pope is such an astonishing poet, and I'm not an 18th century man, but you read The Ways of the Lock, and you forget you're reading heroic Culbert. He knows how to make that very rich of verse form sublimate itself to his language. Robert Frost, who we did not tell him about, part of the media by a wonder of Frost is that everything he does submits itself to the legend. So how does he know it's not written? You see what everything's getting at. Instead of putting the language and idea under the word, I think it's vice versa, and you get something perfect for it. By Sybarite's beguile, we shall no cat decline. Merlin's mighty lion, extreme with nature reconciled, to read the tyrant of his will and made the line. So the poet's written. He's not going to lay around that. They have a good time all the time. No, he's not going to do that. Song can the tempest still, scattered on the stormy air, old years of fair dreams. We shall not teach to read. Here he's just thinking about another winner who put half of his genius to work politically, and as a result, half of his poetry is forgotten again. You don't adapt your poetry to the mystery of the time at all. Wait his returning strength. Bird that from the nadir's floor to the zenith's top can soar. This soaring orbit of the muse exceeds that what profane effect the gift, what compass that thy meddling wit which only the propitious mind publishes in given time. There are open hours in the God's world, and the dull idiot might see the flowing fortunes of a thousand years. Sudden, unaware, self who fly through the door, and stroke forward into the field. This is philosophy. But you see the point again, it's his assertion that the poetic insight, the genius of the poet, expresses itself at its own time, in its own way, does not sublimate itself to political issues, current issues. He had a lot of defending to do during the Greece and the war days. He was out there carrying a banner. I think I want to stop with that and go on to that. Get the image. The next section is all as long, except for a really terrible line.
You have to give us a nozzle.
The rhyme of the poet modulates the king's affairs. Balance loving nature, he often prepares. To every foot, sensitivity. But each color is common, low. To every tone, be answering tone, higher or graver. Flavor gladly blends with flavor. Leaf answers leaf upon the bough. And maps the pair of properties and commands the two. That's the book for science. Maps the pair of properties. Cotyledons are the seed leaves in a plant.
What is he trying to say?
He's saying everything is paired in nature. So if you see a leaf on a plant, there's another leaf attached to it. He's talking about balance here, really. How you ever get the word cotyledon in a lot of poetry, I don't know.
I know, but
give us a couple lines and we'll turn around. Yeah, all things in nature, in other words, being here. Nothing is isolated, nothing is alone. We have to find balance. In one, a hand to hand and feet to feet, in one body, groom to bride. Eldest writes, two married sides never more to meet. Light's far furnace shines, melting walls and bars. Forging double stars, glittering twins and signs. And then he finds curious about the craft of life. The animals are sick with love. Love sick with love. Each is a suspicious time. The chorus rolls. The point is that poetry is imperfect in nature. Pairing the balance of not only ideas but also the way it's set. Just as all elements seem to be a man and woman, body and soul. Even the leaves on a tree, he says, the paired cotyledon, marching hand in hand, which is a ridiculous image every time I see it. And so he pulls us along, and it's matching.
But it's so true of flowers.
It is true.
It is
so true. But it's still ridiculous poetry.
it's a bad word in poetry.
Yeah. Even hand in hand is so ridiculous. I always have an image of a cartoon. going down like animals in Noah's Ark. Cotyledons don't have hands. I created the Chicago style poetry. There's a sentence right there. You're going to pair the cotyledons, you don't need to do it. Like the dancer's ordered band, thoughts come also hand in hand. And equal couples mated, or else alternated, adding by their mutual gaze one to other, health and age. Solitary fancy flows. Most like two bachelors or an ungiven maid, not ancestors, with no posterity to make the lie, praise, or keep truth in the game. Perfect pair is equal to wings. Justice is the line. Praise and counting use the self same truth of use. And nemesis with even matched odds, with thwart, space redresses the partial wrong, fills the just period. We've got a lot of innocent essays. Long-term belief that this is about our life. I'm not sure I accept the person for long, but people don't talk. The evil is the long-term. Nature, God, to take care of it all. But all the same, the end is so beautiful. We just finished a terrible section. But this last stanza was nice. Summer rhymes. It's ruined life. For me, that is a classic poem. It has really something, and something incredible to think. The same man wrote it. But the image, you see, who believes in that last stanza is very important. Subtle rhyme, ruin, life, he says, moon, house. It's in nature. That's where a poet finds its source. Your rhyme has to be in tune with the way things are in terms of God's presence in the world and nature. Not imposed on it by human mind, not the intellect. That's the romantic of human imagination. That's Merlin. Don't use it. I very seldom use that whole film. It's not badness. Let's go back to our essay. Experience. We were talking about illusions and the first lord of life. Let's put our list on the board again from last week. At the end of the essay, he lists them as illusion, temperament, okay, succession, surface, surprise, reality, and subjectiveness. Now what we want to remember as we pursue this is that these are lords of life because they are frames of mind. The ways we see the world around us that limit us. And the essay, in typical Emersonian fashion, approaches these things in sort of a random, unconnected way. You have to read the essay very closely, which is why it's fun to read it closely. You see Emerson's mind flashing off here, flashing off there, but never giving you what you most want. What teachers are supposed to do when they teach, which is a nice, neat series of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These topics you list, but they don't appear in the essay like that. The first of the ways we limit ourselves is our intention, our willingness to perceive life as primarily illusion. Something else always having, remember, a greater attractiveness to us. Other people having happier conditions. So on page 257, he's talking about this obliqueness, the casualness of life. He says, just now on to the second category, there's a lot of reading together today to see how far we can get it in that experience. Moving up to temperament. The neat thing about the Lord of Life is you can use one to destroy another one. Everybody else is happier than me. And we all know people who have submitted to this Lord of Life. There's no sense. One way you attack us is recognize that illusion is what we call temperament. It's a frame of mind. It's what you are. But that's also a Lord of Life. So most of them is breaking through, seeing things new, and not saying good fences make good walls, as though it were a rule of existence. So he says, dream, never let me dream. There's no reason to illusion. All we do is go from one to another. Often. Life is a train of moves, like a string of beads. As we pass through them, they improve. Life is like a string of beads in front of your neck. You see through them, green, yellow, pink. The problem is, if you look through the rosy-colored lens, it's rosy, and everything looks just great, but that's just as much a illusion as a result of your person. As the dark lenses are the person next to you, it says life is, let's say it's with never any happiness. And we know people like that, too. So there's nothing satisfying. So what we do as individuals, you can also go from rosy colored glasses to green colored glasses, dark colored glasses, and we're the victim of the way we see what we see. Remember last fall, throughout that series was Emerson says, see things right. Re-see, constantly re-see. We don't live in habit, only possess it. vision is his image. From the molecule to the molecule. We animate what we can, and we see only what we animate. It's a circular world we live in. Nature and book belong to the eyes that see them. It depends on the mood of a man whether he shall see the sunset or the fine color. Constantly bringing changes upon our own system. If I'm happy, feeling good, I'll see right here in the morning. But frequently, I'm coming into work, and I am thinking about what I'm teaching, or I'm not really happy, or whatever. Eleanor will come up and say, Jerry. Well, did you go to the bridge today?
Yeah.
It was wonderful. Well, I know where I was. I was imperceptive of what was right in front of my car window. There are other days when I have accidents because I'm trying to see right here and the cat and the Olympics at the same time, you know, looking out this way and then through the rearview window to see the same beauty. So, and we all know this, don't we? We simply frequently have this inability to see outside of our temperament, which is a way of breaking the fact that there's nothing of substance out there, but still is also about the Lord. There are always sunsets. There are always kingdoms. The sunsets are great. The gray of a Seattle winter sunset has its own beauty if you were to look at it. And always listen. How often do you listen? But only a few hours so serene that you can relish nature or criticism. The more or less depends on structure. If you make a marginal comment, if you put the temperament down, comes up in somewhat different context. But there it is. Now we're at part two. Temperament is the iron wire on which the beads are strung. We see his image. What we are from them to continually see through is based on our temperament as well. And the beads, which is the illusion of the temperament of the thing. Of what use is fortune or talent to a cold and defective nature? I've had students over the years, wonderfully talented, but unwilling to do anything with them. I've got a kid right now, third career. Wonderful junior. Very, very bright. But more interested in new wave rock music than doing anything else. I'm kind of getting excited about it. But when he leaves my classroom, he still goes back to his home rock and listen to it. Who cares what sensibility or discrimination a man has at some time shown if he falls asleep in a chair? Is that true?
Yes.
Or if he laugh and giggle, implying what? Shallowness. Or if he apologize, oh pardon me, I was wrong.
Right.
Now, no matter how, in other words, no matter how sensitive, discriminant he might be as a person, if his temperament is shallow, uninvolved, easily abused when it shouldn't be, he's trapped by that. Or is infected with egotism, or thinks of his dollar, or cannot go buy food, or has gotten a child in his boyhood. What a trap. You can have a child when you're 15, and no matter how your genius is, find yourself trapped in a factory the rest of your life. There is that thing. The temperament, the willingness to submit to a particular craving at one time, ruins your life. Or what use is genius if the organ is too convex or too concave and cannot find a focal distance within the original, within the actual horizon of human life? Well, that's a really neat one. You know, he's using a vision image again, right? Convex or concave, meaning too nearsighted or too far-sighted. What if you're a genius, but your image of perceiving the world is too, you know, get it right, too concave, therefore focuses reality beyond reality and behind it. So you never see, you have to live in this world. You never see reality. Or if you're such a convex genius that everything you imagine takes place way beyond actual life. Emerson's point will always be you have to live in this world as well. One of his defenses, I mean. People say, why aren't you out there building a cabin and wall and bonds? I'm living in this world. The life is a system. I tell it to my kids all the time. The world says, get out there and test them. I say, I got a lot of time. What is it? I say, yeah, the power is able. That's living in the world. You must, in other words, live here with people as well. Of what use is if the brain is too cold or too hot, and the man does not care enough for results to stimulate him to experiment and hold. Like the weather, too hard to go, too irritable, of what used to make heroic vows of amendment to the same old lawbreakers to keep them. Every New Year's Eve, I vow to give up the cigarette or whatever. I'm going to improve my life. I see it in the journal every quarter. This quarter, I'm going to do my homework. I know I can get that D, and I will do it. And at the end of the quarter, well, next quarter, I will do my. Of what use making the low vows and the same old lawbreakers to keep them? Perhaps again. I know a witty physician who found the creed in the biliary duct. He used to affirm that if there was disease in the liver, the man became a Calvinist. And if the organ was sound, he became a Unitarian. Very mortifying is the result of experience that some unfriendly excess or imbecility neutralizes the common disease. We see young men who owe us a new world, so readily and lavish as they promise, but they never assist with us. Die young and die free from it. Or if they live, they live in God and God. One of the pleasures of reading Emerson is this constant shift in consciousness. And the face of it is really funny. And then the next one is how often do you see people? Anybody with education, many of you with teachers, know the genius and the talent, the possibilities. And we saw that he says, either an apple or something. See it all the time. So he goes on, and he says, temperament also enters fully into the system of illusion, and shuts us in a prison of glass. Now you know what I meant by the older Emerson. Well, yeah, not the wrong man, not self-reliant in nature. There is an optical illusion about every person we meet. In truth, they are all creatures of given temperament, which will appear in a given character whose boundaries they never pass. If you look at them, they seem alive. The moment of the cost, in the year, in the lifetime, the cost of the and resist the conclusion in the morning, but a doctor of the evening wears on, and takes the day off of the get up and go home and have fun. Work through his life. There was this point here, fairly simple. When you're 20, you do something and someone says, wow. He's got his future ahead of him. Same thing when you're 30, 40, 50, and most of us never really reach that point that we're married and we're going to go home. My students ask him frequently, talked about possibly everything else. Would you do it over again? Would you have made a choice in college to be where you are today? And I said, well, no, this is something else. I'd be rich instead of a teacher. Mm-hmm. My father was right. I should have been a physician, a lawyer, or something like that. And when I say that, I always finish by saying, of course I'd be the same person. I'm the same person I was then. I am who I am. And I made decisions based upon my principles or my beliefs or standards or attractions or whatever they are, and they're in us right now. We do two things with high school kids. One is to tell them, keep your doors open. Don't shut your door. I say it in English now, and thereby making it impossible to go through numerous senses of occupation in life. But the other is to point out you're creating a person today that you will be when you are tomorrow. If you start your life at 18 by paying no attention, harmful of others, maybe you have a country, unfortunately, you establish your pattern. So you do both things, you warn and encourage.
I remember years ago, somebody asked how does the plan is how God can know what we're going to do at that time if we have free will.
I, of course, from the other angle, that we tell them that the paradox of predestination is how not that God determines that you will go to hell, but God knows you're going to make the wrong choices from the beginning. He gives you the freedom to be the person you will, and most of us make the wrong choices, and therefore need his help for salvation. That's right, sure, it's a good image. It's sort of disheartening at times what to think about it. So he says, I thus express the law as it is read from the platform of ordinary life. Now watch, anytime you get that in there, it's necessary. The Emerson won't give you the normal clues of relationship. But occasionally you'll throw in a sentence that sets you up. And he says, this is what we see, the delusion and temperament, when we look at it just with our ordinary mind. Ultimately, Emerson will not leave it there. He seldom does that. He takes the time for something better. But his original point is, there really is no escaping these things. You are the person you are. But I must not leave it without noticing the capital exception. For temperament is a power which no man willingly hears anyone praise but himself. On the platform of physics, we cannot resist the contracting influence of the so-called science. Temperament puts all divinity to rout. Then you will not talk about phrenology. I hear the chuckle of the phrenologists. Theoretic kidnappers. Slave drivers. They esteem each man the victim of another, who winds him around his fingers by knowing the law of his being, and by such cheap signboards as the color of his beard and the scope of his occiput, reads the inventory of his fortune and character. The grossest ignorance is not discussed by this imputed knowledge. This is the beginning of the scientific, for us, psychological phenomenon. And if you have ever approached modern feminist response psychology, reading, you know how offensive people like B.S. Spinner can be. For all of human society is predetermined by stimulus and response. If I kick you in the knee, you will kick out. But it's not just physical behavior, it's all social behavior, personalities. Emerson can understand the scientific kind of mind that people are organizing. If you were a phrenologist, I would remember psychology. If you know enough about the shape of the head, you will know why a person is. So all I would have to do is we've got to find a proper bump on her human head. And we know that she is an extrovert because she was wrapped on the head by a baseball bat when she was four, and as a result she's got this big lump. Emerson can't stand that. But you see what it does? He says the result is that there's no such thing as divinity at all. Everything is science. Everything is accident. She despises it. This essay was written, by the way, in a time when phrenology was a major force for debate in America. Hawthorne was also very interested in wrote most of his characters in chronological form. So if you read a full story and the eyes are blocked, large, glistening eyes like Betty Davis' eyes, that's a chronological thing. If you have large, luminous eyes, then you can have an overgrown faculty, urban love of life. Long level of life in your time. Is that true? I have to get off there. Lygia has it too. She's my friend's cousin. If physicians say they are not materialists, but they are. Spirit and matter reduced to extreme thinness. Oh, so thin. This is Edgar Allan Poe. It's Poe theory. If you've ever read Eureka, about it to the abstract quality of Poe theory. What made Poe's point terrifying death. Because he really believed that there was no such thing as spirit, except in kindness and materialism. And the material rots, so the spirit rots. The terror of death is captured with belief that there really is no such thing as the soul. Poe was the ultimate materialist. And notice I have a written remark in Poe. But the definition of spiritual should be that which is its own evidence. What notions do they attach to love? What to religion? I would not willingly pronounce these words in their hearing and give them the occasion to claim them. You can find yourself in that situation closely with somebody who knows all about life, who's already determined there is no God, there is no love, there is nothing of value or something anywhere. Social party people. And you dare not say, thank God for the beautiful name, because they will start dumping their the know-it-all that's on them right away. I saw a gracious gentleman who adapts his conversation to the form of the head of the man he talks with. I had fancied that the value of life lay in its inscrutable possibility, in the fact that I never knew in addressing myself to a new individual what may befall me. I carry the keys of my castle in my hand, ready to throw them at the feet of my lord, whenever and in what disguise soever he shall appear. I know he is in the neighborhood, hidden among vagabonds. So I preclude my future by taking a high seat and adapting my conversation to the shape of heads. You can name it, right? It's astrology. What are you? Oh, you're a master. Now I know how to treat you. I've got you all the way to the limit to find that highly offensive. When I come to that, the doctor is the line you question. But sir, medical history, the report of the institute, the proven facts. See, I distrust the facts. And the inferences. Temperament is the veto or limitation power in the Constitution. Marginal note there. Very justly applied to restrain an opposite excess in the Constitution, but absurdly offered in the bar for legal languages. It has its place, to notice this point, where we are attacked by grace, which is all that I am, in any kind of sense. But don't use it as a bar. When virtue is in presence, all subordinate powers flee. The problem is, on its own level, he says, or in view of nature, temperament is harmless. What does that mean? Sure, if you are willing to be submissive to temperament, you can't go beyond it. In other words, he means the final judge, the final ruler. No way of going about it. She's cold-hearted. He's irascible. Go back to the Middle Ages. The melancholy, the splenetic, right? You name it, you've got it. You can't overcome it. He's not willing to be. Stop. You can, yes, yes. So that in ordinary life, you are sort of trapped on this. But he's not willing to stop at that level. If you are willing to use power, later on, you can break through that. In a sense, what he's saying is that I may have a naturally balanced power. But that's my understanding. What do I do with a person? Do I go through life submitting to it? Or do I stand up and use my free will aggressively to overcome it? We can do that. We can fight our people. I mean, I want you to remember when the baby's sanguine. Yeah, but the point is, I don't worry about that either. There are times to be sad as well. James characterizes the human psyche as an octahedron, or a large ball with eight sides or so. Okay. And he says the side that's on the table, if you look at it, is your current consciousness, your personality. It's a study of religious conversion, really, in many ways. But he characterizes it as very gently balanced on the table. And that when a person makes a radical personality change, what's happened is that something has nudged that ball. And often, personality change is fast, fast. He says, you've got no time. So I like the idea of somebody did abuse anyway. There's a lot going on here that we are not in control of immediately. Many sides of ourselves. If you don't watch out, if you do watch out, still may go over. Unlike what Emerson says, the phrenologists or many psychologists say, but yeah, in that sense, I'd be much more indian than more. But I think everything I find that interesting. Yeah. Even Temperament, this does, however, have a scientific capture in it, that there is a limitation. He says all of this is reason. We're all nascent with the opposite. It is impossible. On its own view level, or in view of nature, temperament is final. Derived from religious experience. It's great for us. Immobility and absence of elasticity that you find in the art, you find yourself in the artist. And if you see the point, what is that work? Why is it more painful in the artist than it is in the art? Right. You may eventually get worn out with no reason. After all, it's a static, completed creation. In literature, I've over the years that the number of books that I can take, teaching over and over and over, without feeling defeated eventually, and even a grade, is very few. In fact, I can make a difference in the book you can teach. I don't know if they record it in time for 2 years. But even Huckleberry Finn, which I'm teaching right now, in about 2 years, I don't see that much. And that's what he's talking about. Because in essence, for us, we are greater than we are. Doing the Bible, by teaching a portion of the book of Job in my sophomore class last week. I'll show you how far after this season is generated. I got a student from the journal saying, I really don't think Job ought to have, but the writer ought to have had Job say that to God. I put a marginal note, who do you suppose the writer was? But I was thinking about that here. Here is a student who feels that he's assumed the book of Job. Wrong, but still, yes, but it's much sadder to find the artist who has not, we all know this is both literature and visual art and music, I suppose, too. Now, teaching, when I get back to the teaching, I'm teaching the art. A classic example of a writer who knew how to do one thing and another. So every Red Heart story feels like every other Red Heart story. It feels great to read the outcast of the class. Less great to read Tennessee's Partner, tedious to read The Luck of Roaring Camp, and anything else that is impossible, because it's the same goal. The great writer, the great genius, grows to fly up into life, but the compromise is always interesting. He doesn't stop. He wasn't developing. And if he was in a bad phase, he went on to something else. So what we need is elasticity. There is no power of expansion in men. Our friends early appear to us as representatives of certain ideas which they never passed or exceeded. They stand on the brink of the ocean of thought and power, but they never take the single step that would bring them there. How often have you seen this? A man is like a bit of Labrador spar, which has no luster as you turn it in your hand until you come to a particular angle. Then it shows deep and beautiful color. There's no adaptation. Greatly keeping themselves where and when that current shall be offered to the Father. But sad, but it's also, I feel best right here. I'm doing what I know if you put this book out of my hand and put the remembrance of things past in it, you would be in misery, and so would I. I can see Emerson, I think, fairly well. I don't know what's going on in his head. So he says, one of the problems of life is to put that piece of stone or star so that you see the building open in time, not all of them. We do what we must, call it by the best names we can, and would fain have the praise of having intended to resolve these issues. Like that, right? We do the best we can, and then we hope we get credit for the good results, if we're lucky. I cannot recall any formal man who is not superfluous. But it's not this pitiful. Of course, it needs the whole society to give the symmetry we see. Now, anytime you read Emerson, you go right back to last fall. Here we are with the American song, man laboring, man farming, man doing. But it's all of mankind make up man. And what we need to do is recognize that we only are valued in context of other human beings and other people doing their work. Nothing will make me a good painter. I don't have a skill. I have a whole brush in my hand. But I have certain skills. So we need that to remove ourselves from isolation. Remember what we call using narrow selfishness. The party-colored wheel must revolve very fast if we are white. Something is earned, too, by conversing with so much folly and defect. And find whoever loses, we are always moving. Whatever happens to the individual, keep your eye on all the time you know about it, just as you understand it as a human being, you can always be able to. Cliche, every call it a divine, but not everyone can succeed. Divinity is behind our failures and problems. That's what it is. And it does the system. Why he's fun to read, and for sure, is the recognition that it's going to be the problem. Maybe more failures and problems. The plays of children are nonsense. So it is with the largest, tallest things. Hunger, government, church, barracks, the history of every man's bread and the ways by which he is comfortable. Like a bird which delights no where the cocks are, but perpetually from bough to bough, is the color which abides in no man and in no woman for a moment. Great. Emerson gets trapped in an essay, but he does it skip around. Try over again. All teachers of essays find him the most frustrating of writers. But what help from these fineries or pedantries? What do we get out of it? What help from the thought? Life is not. Emerson also has an argument for something else, that even when you're reading an essay like this, it's so much thought, so much impulse, the meaning, the action, and such itself. You're not alive unless you're living. So you're very basic. Compulsory Emersonian movement of action to get out there and do something about it. The interior of the artist is worthless if he's doing something, making his mistakes, making his genius the genius. We, I think, in these times have had lessons enough of the futility of criticism. Of course, as a publishing author, we've had plenty of that. But it doesn't do any good. Our young people have thought and written much on labor and reform. And for all that, they have written either the world or themselves have gone on step. And we are reading for the first time the event of the 20th century. His period, 1840, 1850 in America, was probably the most active time in this country for reform. He's a former Colbert student, a wild child. Among them, the one he's going to refer to in this paragraph, which Waldo went to his book farm and tried to live a utopian life. Waldo Emerson was awful hard to steal pigs and write novels at the same time and gave up pigs, but not as he said. Intellectual tasting of life was not supersede muscular activity. If a man should consider the nicety of the passage of a piece of bread down his throat, he would starve. You can't spend your time thinking about it, but it's a fact that you try to you have to pick it up and eat it. At Education Farm, said in the Marvin Farm, and Emerson was involved with that as well, The noblest theory of life sat on the noblest figures of young men and maidens, quite powerless and melancholy. It would not break or pitch upon a page. It would not rub down a horse. And the men and maidens, they left still. Now, this is Hawthorne's summary. But Hawthorne tells us from the other point of view. Hawthorne realized that he was right when he wanted to rub down the horse. But you can't do both. Is live in life as well as think. You can't become. The cause of regret is becoming all this life, which is here to watch the pictures of the sound. That's the cause of curious because, you know, Emerson and Thoreau, they were very interested in Indian philosophy, well aware of Indian and various manifestations, so they sort of knew what was going on there. Yeah. At Education Farm, okay, a political orator literally compared our party promises to Western Groves, whose open stately enough with planted trees on either side to the traveler, but soon become narrower and narrower and ended in a squirrel track, not a tree. So it does culture with us. Go to the Louvre, you find yourself for the first time in the Louvre, and you walk down and you know you've got a list of things you must see, with the Mona Lisa and the picture of Santa Claus. And after 3 hours, if you see Mona Lisa from 50 yards away, you should dot it off and cut off your lunch. Which is what we did. We just took Carl's work and went, all right, we see, is that it? Yeah, okay. Now I can, for the rest of my life as a teacher, I can talk about, well, when I saw the Mona Lisa, the Louvre. Not when she saw the Mona Lisa. So you start out with the best intentions. The first item you look at. I'll give you another example. The same thing is in the, what's the, is it the orangery? And you need a pump, a little building outside the booth that has your intention. You should have come. You walk in, and the first painting you see is Van Gogh's sunflowers. And you're astonished to stand there. This is the actual window in the wall of the apartment you ever saw. And then you turn around, and it turns out that every single painting you've done, every single wall you've ever seen in your life, and you get overkill. You cannot give. With one of those paintings that any one of our provincial museums would give us a reason to go to the museum 2 or 3 times a year and look at it. And here they're not good enough to get into the Louvre. Overkill, headaches. I had the best intentions about Louvre. I don't want to go off and sit in the park for a while. This is what you're talking about. Unspeakably sad and barren does life look to those who a few months ago were dazzled with the splendor of the promise of the times. There is now no longer any right course of action or any self-devotion left among the Iranis. Okay. Emerson's lightning-like insight, where did that come from? I don't know. Somebody said it to him. They started out all right, but nothing happened to the Iranian Revolution. Objections and criticism. There are objections to every course of life and action, and the practical wisdom is further and differences from the omnipresence of objections. Because for so many people, objections to everything, anything, anybody would do, what is the practical wisdom do? Take Laura. You live among carpers the whole time. The whole range of things, creatures. Do not praise yourself in thinking. Go about your business anywhere else. Life is not intellectual or critical, it's dirty. Its chief good is for well-mixed people who can enjoy what they find without question.
Keep an ear when you read Emerson to when you start coming very often after you can go along with our life.
This is right. If you live a solid life, get your food, 3 meals a day, get out there, both feet on the ground, forget about all these theorists, you know, and send you up, knock you over. Nature hates peeping, and our mothers speak her very sense when they say, children, eat your victuals and say no more about it. Right? The kids say, I don't like asparagus, turnips, spinach, parsnips, rhubarb, zucchini. Right? How long will a mother allow that to go on before she says enough? Right? True. And then here is the statement. To fill the hour. Fill the hour, leave no crevice for a repentance or an approval. You did the big purposes. The true art, life is more. So that's how he sneaks that in. One of his major characters, one of his major categories sneaks in here practically on a subordinate clause. But he's moved on, obviously, from, well, first it's this and that, it's your opinion and my opinion. And he says, well, a solution to one thing after another is, take it cool. Get on thin ice skating image. And he and Emerson and Hawthorne used to go ice skating on the Concord River together. Literally, middle age. Can you see them? And the author, I reviewed that fall, said it was wonderful because each one ice skating is his own philosophical fashion. So I thought that was really nice. So we live amid surfaces and the true art of life is to skate on. Get up there, don't fall through. Before the ice cracked. Under the oldest and moldiest conventions, a man of native force prospers just as well as in the newest world. And that by skill of handling, of treatment, you can live anywhere. You have to know the truth. You can live well being a Hindu, you can live well being a Confucian, you can live well being Buddhist, Roman Catholic, Unitarian, Presbyterian, what's the most recent? Whatever. Like, find a principle, live on it, make it through life. Christian scientists, do this is all with us, one after another, he's right. Well, he had nothing to do with that either. Life itself is a mixture of power and form. Will not bear the least excess of either. We're talking about balance. To finish the moment, to find the journey's end in every step of the road, to live the greatest number of good hours. We've heard this before. This is practically. It is not the part of fanatics, or of mathematicians, if you will, to say that the shortness of life considered is not worth caring whether for so short a duration we were sprawling in one or sitting high. With our offices of moments, what's happening? That's great. If I asked that to my junior, it's like, well, I'm teaching paradise here. Yes. Since we in fact live hour by hour, let's take care of our lives. It's the best hour we can. 5 minutes of today are worth as much to me as 5 minutes in the next millennium. The cliche is, bird in the hand. Let us be poised and wise to our own today. Let us treat the men and women well. Treat them as if they were real. Perhaps they are. Men live in their fancy like drunkards whose hands are too soft and tenuous for successful labor. It is a tempest of fancies. And the only balance I know is respect and respect. Without any shadow of doubt, amidst this vertigo of shows and politics, I settle myself ever the firmer in the creed that we did not postpone, refer, wish that you draw justice for the eye. By whomsoever we deal with, accepting our actual intent and circumstance, however humble or odious, as a mystic official to whom you will be able to afford and support, to lead us out of the church. But it is not the only way of seeing it. But part of the curiosity of the Emerson philosophy is that each of these is true as an escape from the other. It has a lot of actual validity. But if you stay on that level, you crash. Got that more reflective manual vision over us. If these are mean, okay, and malignant, their contentment, which is the last victory of justice, is a more satisfying echo of the heart than the voice of force, and the casual sympathy of admirable Christians. I think that however a thoughtful man may suffer from the defect and absurdity of truth, not without affectation denied to any critical ability, sensibility to a out there being aggressive and making it very clear. I'm not going to be. If she's going to be boring, then I'm going to be different. I'm going to be like the best. I long ago passed a woman in the paper class. I listened to movies because I wanted to be a student. And so I'm good. I'm good. I don't want to hear what he's saying. And knocked her back on her feet, made her defend herself. She got a lot more interesting when she was self-pressed. Instead of just being allowed, she was used to speaking to people 20 years old. And you take an education professor and put them against somebody who actually was taught, which is gracious, they haven't seen for years. Right? You put some of their theories up against reality, such as all very well and good, but I've got 150 students a day to meet. How do I do that? And they don't have an answer. A lot of fun. Right? The point is, it's a disservice to yourself and to them as human beings. And if she's being boring, it's because she doesn't have an incentive to make it work. And that's it. The coarse and frivolous have an instinct of superiority, if they have not a sympathy, an honor in their blind, capricious way. The fine young people despise life, but in me, and in such as with me are free from dyspepsia. What's dyspepsia? And to whom a day is a sound and solid good, it's a great excess of politeness to look scornful and deprive the company. I am grown by sympathy a little deeper and sentimental, but leave me alone. I should relish every hour and let it brought me. The hot luck of the day is hardly as the oldest gossip of all. Well, let's go into this as well. Okay, I'll take the day on those grounds if I can. I am thankful for small mercies. There's my ground. Praise God for small mercies. All right. Did we hear that? Yeah, praise God for small mercies. I compare it both with one of my friends, who expects everything of the universe and is disappointed when anything is less than best. And I found that I begin at the other extreme, expecting nothing. I'm always full of thanks for moderate guilt. Very good. The old conflict between the optimist and pessimist. Who's the happier man? No? The pessimist, because he's always being happily surprised. The only consolation an optimist has is expecting to get better than optimist. The pessimist, even if things are awful to the pessimist, what can he say? I knew it. You're absolutely right. You can't lose if you're a pessimist. I accept the clangor, jangle of contrary tendencies. I find my accountant socks and boards also. Lucky that they're so little. They give a reality that to the circumjacent experience, such as vanishing meteor and disk, and despair. In the morning I wake, find the old world, wife, days, and mother's consort walking, the dear old, no room, and even the old devil. I humor to say a few things, dear old world, nothing the world right.
The expansion of that adjective to the word wife as well. But the point is still there. It's all right there. On it. If we take the good we find, asking your question,
we shall have deep dimensions. Great gifts are not stopped by knowledge. These are a reason why your mom and grandma used to have everything memorized by the union. But we gave so much comfort to support people who are living in your personal life and not that age. If you don't get it now, you'll never get it. You're waiting for luck. What is the trade of it? Life is what happens when you wait for life. Yeah, the 20th century turned that around. Instead of the afterworld or the year's world to come, what historically what you see is that the oddity of Emerson is that he is the grandfather of most of those good and most of those bad in American culture. I think I did talk about this. Emerson is the one who said, we must respect nature because it is better than nature, but it's better than you, that is your action of God. So if I remember, respect for the spirit. But Emerson also is the one who says, it is made for you. The world is made for you. You are the greatest creation of mankind. And so the people who use the world around you are also Emerson. The Dixie race has as much claim to Emerson as the wilderness society. That's one of the oddities of life. That phenomenon goes right back to Emerson. I think historically, if you went into a history of American ideas, our current emphasis on the moment would be continually done. So it's not a surprise that we are his grandchildren. That is the readers and saints around us all the time. I don't think you'll find a writer who, if you read much of his essays, will expect you more of you have to write, this is the way we are, and the way you are, this is life, this is it. You know? Because we so often have a very hard time. But this is also a sign of greatness. The same thing will happen to you reading Victor. And it will happen to you reading Beowulf. Or the Bible. There's not a better time to do that. But we can keep continuity of idea like that. But we do not do that. The great gifts are not God. They're given good is on the highway. The middle region of our being is a temporary moment. We take value to a thing of the world of the and life is fine. And safety. And that is a safety. Between these extremes is the equator of life, thought, spirit, poetry, and no doubt. So here he says, right back to the Greek, in the way, if you want to become a scientist, you're clear, living in the lifeless realm, if you want to, if you don't want to become a physicist, find the highway. Moreover, in popular experience, everything good is on the highway. A collector peeps into all the pictures up in Europe for a landscape of Toussaint. A crayon sketch of Salvador. But the Transfiguration, the Last Judgment, the Communion of St. Jerome, and what are as transcendent as these, are on the walls of the Vatican, the Uffizi, the Louvre, where every footman may see them. They say nothing of nature, in every street, sunrise in every day, and the sculpture of the human body of the a collector recently bought a public auction in London for 157 guineas, an autograph of Shakespeare. and detect secrets of highest concern and yet unpublished therein. That's the thing that I look like.
What a Bible. What a Bible.
Yeah, you're right. It's a wonderful first hit beginning.
It wasn't the one now, but it can't be because you don't know.
That is.
Sure. And they were Easter songs. It was really nice.
It's not, there are, as I recall, seven fingerprints.
And he does not
spell
too.
There's nothing right there, that's a lot of reading. You can't make up his mind. I think I will never read any but the commonest books, the Bible, Culbert, Doctrine, Facebook, so they don't think you're actually going to be reading this. That's all actually. Then we are impatient of so public a life. I found two of my juniors. They were secretly reading. Because of what people would say, I said a mic, and it was quite all right for me to read a line comedy. You don't have to hide it underneath the table where the reading Playboy opened the audience. I didn't say that. Then we are impatient of so public a life and planet and run hither and thither for nooks and secrets. The imagination delights in the woodcraft of Indians, trappers, and demons. We fancy that we are strangers, not believing to be domesticated with China as a wild man, a wild beast, and bird. But the inclusion reaches them also. Reaches the climate, flying, riding, covered with cooperative man. Rocks and woodchuck, coffins, knife and bittering, and merely seeing them no more living the deep world than man. But our best friends should be different from the world. The kingdom falling back is really a land. Yes. Everybody else has got a wonderful door up, wonderful land of eyes that. You are as alive as anybody else. Don't demean yourself. No words for people in the future. Then the new molecular philosophy shows astronomical interspaces. He picked atom and atom, shows that the world is all outside. And when you find the world is best. Nature, as we know her, is no saint. The lights of the church, the ascetic, been to the corner, she does not distinguish by any favor. Are you here? Do you want a special favor of mine? Are they holy over there? Will they be working God's servants if they suffer his name? In fact, same agency, they are jealous, they are petty, they are good. If you, some of you I know, no friends, you talk to people. One of the grave, burdened country, and none of them care. These days. She comes eating and drinking and sitting. Her darlings, the great, the strong, the beautiful, are not children of our law. Do not come out of the Sunday school, nor weigh their food, nor punctually keep the commandments. Again, we always do not our head. It's not saints who are necessarily going to create the Michelangelo paintings. But if she wasn't there, if we will be strong with her strength, we must not harbor such disconsolate consciences borrowed too from the consciences of our nation. We must put up the strongest present tense against all the rumors of wrath and passiveness, which it is of the first importance. And pending their settlement, we do as we do. Thus, the debate goes forward, and the equity of commerce will not be closed for a century or two. Who are all the movements in China? This is how we talked here about how long it takes for all these movements. A big one in his day was the copyright law. The copyright law is different in America. It resulted in piracy, enormous amount of the law was not settled until the American writers were concentrating on her picture, or are you going to see that speak shop? Things will take care of themselves as long as they will not result in the future. Good number one.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Law of copyright and international copyright that should be discussed. And in the interim, we will sell our books. Expediency of literature, reason of literature, the lawfulness of writing final thought in question. Much to say on both sides. I will fight back to talk and all of your stuff. Out of line with the author. Write the whole man and the property. Grant it, it is much more as they will. But thou, God, darling, heed the private reason. Thou wilt not be missed. Human life is important, made up of two elements, color and form. The proportion must be invariably kept if we would have a few. Here we are now. This goes back to the carry. Color and form. Keep them together. Each of these elements in excess makes a mischief as hurtful as its defect. Everything runs through excess. Every good quality is not a mix. We carry the danger to the end of ruin. Nature causes each man's peculiarity to superabound. Here, among the farms, we adduce the scholars as examples of expression. They are making expression. If you're a farmer, you put this to us. You're talking about, those eggheads over there, what do they do to the people, right? We raise food, we feed the people, but people up there in the energy power, they aren't producing anything for the nation, well. And what do the people up in the energy power say? Well, it's farmers, all they do is toil the ground, they don't do anything for their soul or their spirit, they just give them an idea and all their life. And here, you can be nothing more than a farmer, but you can be also a man of farming. And if you are nothing more than an intellect in the energy power, you see the artist, the orator, the poet too near, and find their life no more excellent than that of mechanics or farmers themselves, victims of partiality, very hollow and angry, pronounce them failures, not heroes, but cracks. You conclude very reasonably that these arts are not for man. What are these millions who read and behold? But it's simply dragons. Add a little more of that quality which now reads and sees, and it will see the truth. And if one remembers how innocently he began to be an artist, it would mean that nature joined with his enemy. A man with a golden impossibility. less broad. The kids, as you say, all these other things are being agreed. Thank you. How easily the faith would suffer if you might keep forever these beautiful minutes. Adjust ourselves once for all to the perfect calculation of the world's possible. It's great to this communication, despite the fear of culture and distance, and the resolution of the fear of the multiplication table you already have. If you know your multiplication table, stick with it. Can you make it through life? They don't teach the multiplication anymore, so it says in my class, the math book, take out your calculator and figure out what 57 divided by 400 is. But now they figure out how to do that. But he doesn't know longer. So, as far as I know, the only thing we get to survive. But presently comes a day, or is it only a half hour? The conclusions of nature and of years. Tomorrow again, everything looks real and angular. The habitual standards are, we have taken common sense because rare genius is the basis of genius. And experience is standard teaching. Habitual standards are reconsidered. In a moment of real acceptance, change you see in the world. Sure thing in the world of tomorrow. The world is a piece of life. You forget the inspiration from genius. Common sense is a rarity. It's a basic belief. An experience is hand to keep learning. How are you doing? Every enterprise is a past. The past creates all things. So if you want to put a nail in a board, you don't figure it out. You don't use genius. You pick it up with your hand, put it in the board, you call it. And if you're a carpenter, you don't make a mistake. You don't even call it. And yet, he says, if you did everything, just on those terms, power keeps quite another road in the turnpike as far as the road. Neighbor, the suffering and physical. There's power waiting. Now, we could do a couple of things. I decided, part of the conversation we had, we really wanted to go on, and we're just saying, are you liking reading the discussion? We can continue and take it mostly to the end, but maybe not to the end. Would you like to do that?
Yes.
If we have time, we can do it, but we don't have to. Surprise is in this paragraph. So here's where we are. Subjectiveness. I got interfered with the board. My habit when I write on the board is to write like this, and then I just subjectiveness. You know?
Yes.
And if they're not listening, they've lost. What does that mean? Well, obviously it says